What happens when an organization has purpose in its DNA? Patagonia, an internationally celebrated outdoor clothing and gear brand, wants to contribute to saving our planet through their business. Patagonia goes so far as to discourage consumers from purchasing too much of its products. We now welcome Gabriel Davies, Ocean Category Marketing Manager of Patagonia Outdoor Clothing and Gear, and also João Macedo, Patagonia Ambassador and Professional Big Wave Surfer. I welcome them both for a talk. The floor is now yours, Mr. Gabriel Davies.
Thank you so much. Good afternoon, everyone, and thank you for having both myself and João to talk to you guys today. I hope you've all had a fantastic day. There's been some fantastic speakers I've been tuning into a little bit. I just wanted to start off. I hope you guys can see my screen here. My sort of story into Patagonia started off on a surfboard in Northeast England. I'm based in Newcastle in Northeast England. And I was a professional surfer for a long time, surfing for many brands, but I saw this book and I read this book, and I really advise anyone listening today to go out and read at this book. It's a fantastic book for anyone who's interested in marketing, anyone who's interested in business, and for anyone out there who wants to make a change. So it's kind of, we know the world's a crazy place right now, but it often feels like it's down to the individuals to make change. And you may be a small person, but you think, you know, there's no way I can make change. But this is a story about Yvon Chouinard, the founder of Patagonia. He was a sort of reluctant businessman. He wanted to be a climber and a surfer, and he started a business as a way to keep enjoying what he wanted to be doing. And likewise, so whenever I read this book as a very keen professional surfer, this was the brand that I wanted to really work for. And luckily, I started working with Patagonia about 6 or 7 years ago. And this is the mission statement of Patagonia. As the introduction kindly said, Yvon Chouinard has put it into the most simple terms, the reason why Patagonia is in business. It's a billion-dollar company. It makes fantastic product. But the one reason that he's pinpointed as to why we're in business is that we are in business to save our home planet. There's this massive statement that he dropped a couple of years ago. And it means that the whole company now has to align behind this mission statement. It's like a huge set of values, and we're probably sitting there as individuals doing our jobs around the world. How do we fit into this like picture? How does an individual working at a desk fit into this picture, whether it's in the marketing or the sales team or the product team? But we've all been sort of drawn to this mission statement, and the decisions we have to make are probably unlike any of the brands that we may have worked for in the past. I've got colleagues who've come from Nike and Converse and North Face, as well as like non-sports brands. And we've all got to like realign our the things we previously held true. You know, like I was with a brand called Quicksilver, and we had to just sell loads of product. And, you know, it was never really about the quality. It was just about sort of growth and consumption and the next colorway. But this really pinpoints down why Patagonia is doing what it's doing, and how, and this is kind of how we're doing it, is by this sort of next level down from the mission statement. So this is actually in Germany. We in a wall in Berlin, and we really wanted to highlight why and how we go about our business. And basically, first boils down, we got to build the best product. You got to build the best jacket. You want a rain jacket that lasts, that you don't have to buy again in 2 years' time because it leaks. You want a wetsuit that's strong. And then when whatever we put into that jacket or that fleece or the t-shirt, it's got to cause the least amount of harm possible. So we know that making things is going to create a sort of, you know, it's going to create harm. You've got to get the dyes, you've got to get the fabrics, it's got to get shipped around the world, it's going to get wrapped in plastic, it's got to go out to, you may make too many of a bright color green and it's going to be difficult to sell. So you've got to really think about why you're making products you make them as best as they can possibly be so they last as long as possible. And then whatever goes into the product, you've got to do it in a really thoughtful way, how you design the product. The last part of this, or how does Patagonia go about its business, is we use our business to inspire and implement solutions to the environmental crisis. So it's like a long phrase, that. But Patagonia is a $1 billion company. It sort of leads the way for a lot of people. It's not perfect. It's not the best company. You know, we probably do things wrong and we get pulled up about it. If we do them wrong, and we know we're not perfect, but we know that the world is in a really difficult place right now. So we really want to use our influence wherever we can to pull people along with us. So we're using this business to like inspire change, and it's largely comes down to how we help the environment. So a simple example of that would be Patagonia was a founding member of 1% for the Planet. So that's 1% of the Patagonia turnover. This is not 1% of profit. 1% of the entire turnover of the company goes to directly towards environmental NGOs, nonprofits. And that's the starting block. It's like a self-taxing starting point. So the least we're going to do, this would be 1% for the Planet of our turnover, but we're going to do way more than that. We're going to do donations and, you know, loads of other things. The B Corporation is another way we sort of self-regulate ourselves, and business, you know, business can be a force for good. If you do business really well and you're doing the right thing, then every other business can follow in your footsteps, you know. And quite often Patagonia has been at a crossroads of a decision. There was a decision made about when we would decide to go into organic cotton on all our products. So we, and the common sense, well, organic cotton is far more expensive than conventional cotton. But so, you know, the prices of the t-shirts are going to go up $10. It's a crazy thing to do. You can't do it. You're not going to sell any t-shirts. You're going to be like, you're going to go broke. No one will buy a Patagonia t-shirt. But sure enough, you go 100% organic cotton t-shirt, boom, the sales of the t-shirt go up. It's an incredible way when you do the right thing. Quite often the market like follows you. And then the other brands follow you as well. So that's a sort of the breakdown of how we make the product, the thought that goes into the product, and how we're using our overall business to help influence the world around us. But we do still have to sell product. Obviously, we still have to sell product. The more successful we are, the louder voice we have. And one of the biggest days of the year for any sort of clothing companies, Black Friday, and we thought about Black Friday, this overconsumption, this huge like greed for a sale, for a discount price, you know, mass consumerism. And we want a marketing team at that point flipped it on its head, and this advert ran in the New York Times, full page, New York Times, don't buy the jacket. You don't need the jacket. If you don't need the jacket, don't buy the jacket. This is not something, you don't just go out and buy something for the sake of it. We want you to, I don't know if you can see, it's probably a little small on the screen. You want to reduce what you use. You want to repair what you've got. You want to reuse what you can, and you recycle what you can't. This is the sort of reimagining of products, and especially clothing, this high turnover, high fashion industry, very, very, very heavy environmental footprint of the clothing industry around the world and on the workforce as well. So we went out and said, don't buy this jacket. Only if you need to. And with all our Patagonia products, we also have a lifetime guarantee. So if you did buy the jacket and the zipper breaks, we'll repair the jacket for free. And it's probably worth you guys knowing, because I'm sure you're largely Portuguese audience, our European repair center is actually in the north of Portugal. So in the north of Portugal, anybody who has a jacket that's been snowboarding, has a fault, it'll go to the north of Portugal, they'll repair it for free. And we ship it back to the customer, and the jacket lives on for another, you know, 2, 3, 4 years, and hopefully gets passed down to the next person. So interestingly enough, we ran the ad, super sort of, you know, caused a bit of a stir. More importantly than that, the sales of the jacket actually went up. So it didn't quite work, but you get the idea of where we were going. So we've talked about the sort of global vision for Yvonne Chouinard, the thought that goes into the product and the influence you want to have, and also the direct influence we want to have as consumers. So we're coming down the sort of from this global vision down to like you and I, like what do we need, what do we want, and where we choose to put our money. You know, we it's really important as the consumer, or even as a business partner, who your suppliers are, and can you have influence down that supply chain and use your influence as a force for good. So you're putting euros where your mouth is, really. Like, you know, got to step up, and you can say, I'm going to use this supplier because they've got this sort of really positive track record, they're fair trade certified, or you know, they're a local organic, or whatever it may be. You know, you got to really be thoughtful about, or, you know, where you do your banking, or is your energy supplier a renewable energy supplier? You know, these are really sort of day-to-day things, whereas a group of people or as a group of businesses, you've got influence. So we're coming down this spectrum. So it's like we've gone from the global vision, the business vision, and then as individuals, and my role within the company, I look after the sort of surf category, the ocean category, we call it. So anyone in the ocean sports or the surf stores, or guys like João, who are like surfing the most incredible waves in the world, just up the road from you guys in Nazaré. You know, you got this fantastic community, and this community cares and it wants to fight for the things it cares about. So if you guys all go to the beach on the west coast of Portugal, you know, you've got the most fantastic coastline there. This image here is Western Australia. Oh, it's Australia. I'm not sure the exact beach, but the campaign in this image is hundreds of surfers who are out there protecting the bight area of the coast. So this is the southern bight of Australia, the large southern Australian coastline, where a company called Equinor, Scandinavian company from Norway, they wanted to drill for oil off these beaches. And the surfers and the local population were really like against this idea. Like, if something goes wrong in that zone, it's a very, very delicate zone with no support vessels for the oil industry, a load of very rare species, you know, migrating whales. And it's a high risk project for an oil company, very, very deep water, very, very stormy seas. And the surfers stood up against this. And one of these surfers in particular is a guy called Heath Josk. He's an ambassador, much the same way that João is. And he was what became a sort of figurehead. You know, he's known for fantastic level surfing, but this really struck home. Like, if an oil spill goes wrong off my coastline, I've got the most to lose, as has the fisherman next to me or the tourism industry down the road. You know, so these little communities really stood up. So this became a sort of surf activism movement. And what Patagonia is very, you know, it's driving, you know, you can do so much as a business. And as a business, you know, they will try and make system change. They will try and, you know, they are getting political. They'll try and go for like the political backing of a candidate that's got environmental values over someone that hasn't. They don't mind stepping into the game. But with this example, is so the guy on the right here, Heath Josk, he's just a surfer from South Australia, very good surfer. But you can see when the uproar that it caused in Australia wasn't really getting across to Equinor, the NGO, the multinational petrochemical company. They still wanted to drill for oil. So we flew Heath to the AGM of Equinor in Oslo. And I was together with Heath at this point. So this is an individual surfer who we supported flying into an NGO, flying into an AGM, sorry, of one of the biggest oil companies in the world. And he handed over about 1,000 signatures directly to the CEO of the company and stood up for 5 minutes in front of all of the shareholders and gave this really impassioned, most powerful speech that I've ever sort of been witness to. And in it, he's transmitting his love for his coastline and where he lives to the shareholders of an oil multinational, demanding them that they appreciate the risk that they're going to and the threat to his coastline. And to me, as a surfer watching Heath do this talk, very out of place, it was probably one of the most powerful 5 minutes I've ever seen of a surfer. You've seen, you know, Kelly Slater or the World Championships, or it's a very, surfing's a fantastic sport, or incredible waves. But for someone to really make change, it actually came down this individual level of this one guy really driving home this passion for what he cares about. And here's Heath. This was again a paddle out in Oslo, out of his comfort zone, but really making change. So I'd really like to think, before we move on to João, who has a fantastic story, João surfs literally some of the biggest waves in the world, one of the world's most respected surfers on your coastline, just up the road from Lisbon. I'm sure you've seen it on the headland or in the newspapers. I want to think, or maybe just challenge you guys to go about your sort of day or your goal in as an individual or as a business or as a student. Like, I'd love you to prove me wrong and say, like, you can make a difference as an individual. You can make a difference. This is Heath. He never in a million years thought he'd go to Scandinavia. He never thought he'd stand up in front of shareholders and demand that they make change to protect the places that he loves. And Heath just started out like a surfer like myself or João or whatever you guys are passionate about. So yeah, I'd say, like, think big, think global, but really try and put your money where your mouth is. Like, go out, do what you can to make change, make positive change, and your influence can ripple out into the world in a really positive way. And the book Let My People Go Surfing is a really good example for that. And doing business differently can be really successful. It's been super successful for Patagonia, and it is that time. I think the last year especially, we've seen how radical the world can change. Obviously not for the best, but the world can really change. And hopefully you guys listening and girls listening can really help be that next generation of, like, go out, make a difference, do things differently. And I'd love to be there in person again to see you guys next year maybe, but we'll wait and see. Thank you so much for your time. I hope I wasn't over. I think we have a video to introduce João, which is a moment to little take a breath, sit back and enjoy some fantastic waves. Thank you all so much. Have a great afternoon.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for allowing me to share this Yeah, this passion for nature, and it was really great to listen to Gabe's perspective and the inner workings of this amazing brand that Patagonia has become, and a global phenomena, and something that I think is all about inspiration, but also making it work. So helping families and being a good business. So thank you very much to Fundação Amélia de Mello for putting on this amazing conference. Nova SBA, obviously, I'm an alumnus, so I'm very proud to be here now and after all these years and representing in a different way. And the Leadership Impact Knowledge Center, which I think is able to put all this together and actually, help mold and inspire minds to have the impact that Gabe was explaining. And there are many pathways, and each one will be unique, and stories are written every day. And so it's really great to see this, hopefully, as a genesis for that, and something that hopefully will continue year after year, because purpose really is at the essence of, I think, of all top performances. And so one of the things that I really do, and big wave surfers actually do go through a lot of stress, although we do live by the beach and we love the ocean and the waves. I think you can imagine a little bit, and that's why the video helps a little bit bring everyone into my world. And so what I'd like to share with you, hopefully bear with me, I've done this over the years, in speaking engagements. So again, this online ability is not as easy, but hopefully just bear with me. And this breathing exercise is all about basically just helping us maintain relaxed. So helping us deal with our stress and at the same time maintain our focus. So I've been doing this regularly over many, many years when I qualified onto the Big Wave World Tour and I was entering the World Surf League world events in Nazaré and some other ones in Mavericks and around the world. And it's just something that really brings you to become more present. So hope everyone is ready. I can't really be sure that you are, but what we're going to do is we're going to breathe in through our nose and breathe out through our mouth for 30 times. And then we're going to hold our breath for around a minute. So this seems maybe very difficult, and it is a little bit, but all I want you to do is after the first challenge or desire to breathe, that you just push it just a teeny little bit further and see if you can reach the minute, reach whatever you can. The whole idea, you can close your eyes, is to stay relaxed. So as we all know, breathing is an essential function of us on this planet, and to be aware of it is something that actually helps us very much also be aware of our surroundings and what we have to do to succeed. Okay, so hope everyone's ready. I'll just demonstrate in through the nose. And that slide will make sense in a little longer. Please wait. Okay, I'm gonna start counting. Please go with me. One, two, three, in, out, five, try to breathe heavily, eight, nine, heavy through the nose, light through the mouth, 12, 13, 14, don't stop. 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, last 10, please keep going, 21, 22, 23, 24, please start preparing your breath hold, 26, 27, 28, last two, 29, prepare your breath hold. So hopefully it's quiet around you and you are feeling that quietness. my goal here is just to try to guide you a little bit so that your awareness is very low because you're in a deep relaxation mode. And at the same time, you're able to overcome some desire to start breathing, and you're honoring the breath hold. Holding your nose is sometimes important if you're not used to breath holds. So we've already passed the halfway mark. Hopefully, some of you are still with me. Okay, this is very good. Whoever's still going, congratulations. You can hang in there just a little bit longer. It will feel good. All right. Very good. 1 minute. Okay. So the goal of this exercise, guys, in the production, can you please just go back one slide? Thank you. So the goal that really this exercise helps me personally, but I really do think that it will help anyone who has to deal with some kind of stress in their life or anxiety or at the same time a desire to perform, a desire to push ourselves. And fear is one of the biggest engines for us to act, but also to freeze. And so the fact that big wave surfers are so aware of fear because of the threat of the giant waves and just the emotional intensity that comes and overwhelms us when we are faced with giant waves is something that at the same time for us to keep doing and for us to make it a profession and make something that we're able to consistently face our fears, we have to tap into abilities and skills and techniques that allow us to consistently perform, to consistently want to go out. And that's why facing our fears is also a gateway to finding our purpose. And so I think this ends up being a very interesting technique because of the introspection aspect, but also the fact that it really does help us calm and kind of see a little bit what is the most important thing that we're doing. And I think not only this conference, but what Gabe was saying about how a whole brand, how a whole company is helping people find their purpose is something that, in a strange sense, is surrounded by fear. Kind of like Gabe said, the fear of launching a campaign that is so outrageous that it might completely flop. The fear of not reaching sales goals, or the fear of not convincing the board, the fear that Heath probably felt when he went in front of an extremely hostile audience at Equinor and was able to convince shareholders who had their interests very aligned with expanding, and at the same time felt that it wasn't the right place to set up their operations. So fear is something that once you become aware of it and you recognize its force, you then become more conscious of ways to overcome it, and you also become a bit more calmer in the fact of accepting it. So in the next slide, I share just some very fundamental values that I think are very easy for us to relate to. And at the same time, we can check in almost on a daily basis. So just like this breathing exercise, hopefully will stimulate some interest in you that when I'm maybe disaligned with my purpose, I can go back to breathing and somehow I will find a pathway back to purpose. If I am out of whack, these next slides, these values, which are fundamental values that I think we all know, but sometimes they're not connected to high performance. And at the same time, or to finding our purpose. And I think that's what's the interesting thing about how big wave surfing is so connected to nature and this violence of nature, besides the aesthetics and the beauty of nature, but that the fact that the violence is so prevalent, and the violence of the waves, the violence, the sounds, all of these things that are so intense for us, and how can we overcome? And another very strong value that is not here, but I can't I can't help myself in making a small escapade here, is the essence, and this was actually one of our hosts said, have fun. And so it seems like an absolutely, again, basic thing, or the opposite, that if you're having fun, then you can't be performing. And at a certain level, after these values to some extent are put into practice, then we are able to, what's said many times is to let go. And when we let go, we are actually, because we prepared so much, because we feel we have a purpose and we have a service, because we're very grateful for everything, for the day that is here, then we are able to actually perform at a much higher level than if we are just so tense and so concerned with reaching the numbers. We are just so concerned with performing that then we lose context, we lose access to our purpose. And so I think gratitude for me has been one of the most important things. And again, this might seem so obvious, but I think all of us, you know, the luck that we are here, you know, we have access to a computer, we have internet. You know, I imagine maybe some viewers might be in a remote part of the world. That would be amazing. But most of us are probably in organized cities with tap water, you know, peaceful surrounding, not in a war environment. And it's so easy to forget that that is not actually a given. That is something that is very precious and very valuable. And surfers, when they're very caught up in their bubble, in their professional bubble of performance, you know, can I move within the top five? Can I get into the top 10? Or can I be world champion? The example that Gabe was giving about probably Heath, this activist who went through that, as the Australians are so competitive. And so if you get too caught up with that, then you forget your surroundings. You forget how good it is to be a surfer and to just be at the beach. And even if the conditions aren't good, you can still have this access to nature. You can still experience nature. And more, and Patagonia specializes in that, is outdoor activities. So activities that connect you to nature, activities that make you experience nature and make you be immersed in nature. And surfing is probably one of the most full immersion activities, sporting activities, because you literally leave land and you enter the ocean, so, or seas. And so from that moment onwards, even whichever level you're at, you are exiting the land where we as a species live and interact. And so that is a very intense experiential moment. And to honor that moment and to do it and to try and not think, oh, I'm not an athlete or I'm not, has been something that over the years I've had an opportunity with my surf school to really see how impactful it is and how that is also a form of activism. Because each person that experiences nature, as I said in my presentation, that is a gateway to them individually finding their purpose. And so I think it's something that organizations have a very big opportunity, and organizations that are based in Portugal even more because of the access to the ocean, but all organizations around the world, be it mountains, you know, snow, ocean, you know, all these activities, which have, there's such a broad array of activities, have an access to be immersed in nature. And that is a gateway to help each individual person that is immersed to revisit their purpose, to help people and organizations to continue to find their purpose. And so I feel very grateful to be able to share this, and yeah, very thankful to not be in that wave, but at the same time, not be under that one, right, Gabe? But at the same time, yeah, share these notes from the field. So thanks so much to Nova. Thank you, Fundação Amélie de Mello, and great to be online here.